they do go into the schools. They do an excellent piece of work with the schools and make sure that children, one of them now, the children think he's Bobby, you know, one of the infant schools. But I've got to go along with David and Rhiannon, who do an excellent piece of work with them, supplying them with the information that's required in the schools. And the safer, as Ron said before, the safer into the schools, all those issues which are being run through David and Rhiannon's department is absolutely brilliant. In all these aspects, it's not just, you know, pedestrian with cycling as well, and all those other educational things that children do. So, the one thing is, if you are taking on more police officers, can we have another constable for Wirral South? We've only got one at the moment. We've only got one, haven't we?
I think it's worth noting that you're actually the first police officer I've seen in over a month. And I think that, in a quite a serious sense, it's quite a sense of the times that we face. Merseyside police have lost over 2,000 people in the space of 3 years. We're seeing police cuts on unprecedented levels. And I'm really impressed to see the amount of cohesion between the council and between Merseyside police, in spite of the severe cuts to their officers. And in terms of Councillor Mitchell and our area, which is Alpha 4, we've seen detrimental cuts to our neighbourhood policing. And Councillor Elderton raised the point of when PCSOs used to be able to go along and you'd be able to see a Bobby on the beat in the area, and we'd be able to work with them to put those signs on cars. We literally haven't got the officers on the ground anymore, unfortunately, to do that. Obviously, you know, got to prioritise where you put officers, but I just thought it's worth noting that just in spite of the severe cuts to the police, changes are being made, and there does seem to be a degree of cohesion amongst the council and the police.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. Is there anybody else with any questions for any of the three representatives we've got here tonight?
I'd like to thank all three of you. And I'd like to thank Ian Campbell, Victoria, and thanks for coming tonight. I'd like to pay tribute to Ian. And what we mustn't forget is the Pedestrian Association, headed by Ian, since he retired, he's put his heart and soul into bringing down road casualty figures. And we mustn't forget that the three people who are sitting in front of us now are all working and doing their very, very best for the safety of the people of Wirral, the people who we represent. So I think I'd like to pay tribute to all three, the police, the Pedestrian Association, and once again, Dave and the technical services team. And the police have had cuts, and the department, our technical services department, and Dave with his road management team have had cuts, and I personally think they're doing a tremendous job to keep us all safe, really. And I'd like to thank all three of you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I'd like now to move on to item 5.
Chairman,
of course we can have a recommendation, Chris. Thank you.
There is a recommendation.
There is. Have you got a recommendation as well, Chris?
Yes.
Okay. Do you want to put your recommendation forward first?
Given the differences between the reports as generated this recommendation, we notice and thank officers for their reports. We thank WPA for their input. However, we commission an independent audit of pedestrian casualties to determine the current position. There's a great difference between both reports. I want to know which one rises.
Chair, can I make a suggestion?
No. Have we got a seconder for that, please? You've got a seconder. Okay. What we'll do is we'll vote on that recommendation from Councillor Blakeley and seconded by Councillor Williams. And then we'll go on to any other recommendation. So all those, have you got a note of Chris's recommendation? Did everybody hear that, so everybody knows what they're voting on? All those in favour?
I couldn't be saying any more than they might be friendly.
Right, Phil, are you coming with a rec? We have got a recommendation in front of us here. So, in my opinion, as the chair, we don't need any other recommendations. We've got a recommendation here that covers the items that we've just spent an hour and a half discussing. And Councillor Blakeley is well within his rights with the recommendation he's made, so we're now going to vote on it. So there's no other recommendations apart from the recommendation I've got here to carry when we've dealt with Councillor Blakeley's recommendation. Is that okay? So all those in favour of Councillor Blakeley's recommendation, please raise your hands. Okay. All those against? Okay, that's lost 4-10. Thank you. Now,
can I make a recommendation?
The recommendation of the committee, if I put my glasses on, note the information contained within the report, endorses the current holistic approach to casualty reduction and promotion of schemes and initiatives which will assist the reduction of all road casualties. All those in favour? Oh, excuse me. Can I have a seconder for that, please? Right, we've got a couple then. All those in favour? I think that's unanimous. Thank you. Thanks, Dave. We now move on to item 5, customer contact update report, and I'd like to invite Lisa Jameson, please, to give us that report. Thanks, Lisa. I see there's two of them. Or am I seeing double?
No. I brought a colleague to you to do it.
I know. Nice to see you, Jerry. Nice to see you. Thank you.
Okay, so I think it's the first time for me to meet the majority of the people in the room, so I'll introduce myself. I manage the Transaction Centre, and more recently I've been given the responsibility of project manager for the customer contact. Okay, so I think the reason for me being here follows on from IT colleagues attending the Transformation of Resources Policy and Performance Committee earlier on in the year, and when issues and queries were raised, they come and delivered from an IT perspective to the committee. There was a lot of questions around what we're doing around our customer contact currently, what we're doing to get them.
Could I ask you to speak up? But I'm one of the people at the back.
Can you hear me now? Okay, I'll probably be really loud now. As I say, IT colleagues were given many questions and issues raised around customer contact, how we're managing customer contact now, things that we need to do to get it right, and also what the future of customer contact looks like. So the purpose of the report that I've written, it's a high-level summary, but I think the most important part of the report at the moment is the work that's underway. So I'd like to go through that work that's underway, but also to touch on the vision for transforming the customer contact. And I've invited Julie with me, obviously, from a customer service management perspective. So I think it's obvious that customer contact is a major transformation project in the authority. And customer expectations do change as digital technology changes. I think it's become apparent, I've been with the authority for a year now, and it's become apparent that, like other authorities and many organisations, we didn't anticipate the impact that channel shift would have on our customer contact channels. I think one of the things that we did was we moved a lot of our resource out before we'd actually made the changes, and the realisation of that now is that our main objective is to now look to get things right. So the future model for customer contact, we've basically built a vision called Access Wirral, and the point of Access Wirral is to establish a front door for all of our customers, our residents, and to enable them a seamless contact through to whichever department of the authority they wish to get in touch with, both through a seamless process and a one-door approach. I've met with a lot of members since I've been here, and most recently with Councillor Matthew Patrick, and there's a lot of work underway that we've taken on board comments and feedback that I've received personally, but also from a wider spectrum. So we've got a lot of work underway at the moment, and I'd like to go through that work that we've put in place and also the work that we've got in the pipeline, particularly around our contact centre and our front of house. So recently we've had lots of feedback about the length of time when people actually wait in the queue. So this feature that we've now implemented across the call centre is to enable people to be told what their position is in the queue. Feedback previously indicated that people felt they were waiting and waiting, and there was a never-ending wait. So the purpose of implementing the position in queue means that people are now told, on average, how long they're going to wait, and it gives them the option to either hang on or call back. To further support that, we've also said that we'd be able to give an average on how long you will be waiting in the queue, so not only a place in the queue, but also how long you can expect to wait. And that's based on an average of the number of calls that are waiting to get through. Further and more recently, what we've added on to this is customer callback arrangements. And that came from meetings with Councillor McLachlan and the leader. And there were extensive discussions around things that they've seen in other authorities. I've also done a lot of work around researching other authorities over the last year, and also bring experience from managing multiple contact centres and transactional services across other authorities. So what we're going to introduce is customer callback. That means that the customer has the opportunity to hold a place in the queue, and they will basically be called back within a set time to have their inquiry dealt with. We've also, from the one-stop shops, one of the main gripes of some of customers was that they would use the electronic online forms to submit their applications for benefits. But we would expect, in accordance with our verification framework, that the evidence that was provided was real evidence and it was taken in to the one-stop services to support the application. With DWP support and guidance, we've reviewed the verification framework, and what we now do is accept electronic documentation. So not only can the person claim online for the benefits and other changes and circumstances that they wish to report, they don't now have to go into the one-stop shops to book an appointment or to wait to be seen to submit the evidence to support that. They can actually upload that now. That doesn't mean to say that it takes away the possibility and the opportunity to go into the one stops and have appointments and take that documentation in, but it has streamlined our processes and made them really efficient. So we expect to see a take up on that more in the coming months. Reduction in the message length, what we found that a lot of our customers were saying that they had to go through really lengthy messages to get where they needed to. So a piece of work went ahead to a workshop with the contact centre manager to review all those messages and be more direct so that we could shorten the initial message that customers hear when they call us back, when they call us. Service level agreements are currently underway with our back office. What we tend to find is that a lot of our customer contact is avoidable contact. So recently we've done a lot of work around the scripts that our contact centre and our one-stop services go through when they're taking calls from our customers, whether that's street scene, whether that's revenues, benefits, whatever the nature of the call is. We've done a full review on those scripts. Over the last year or so, or the last couple of years, we have lost significant skill from the front of house and the call centre, and we're working, really putting a lot of effort in also made sure that the scripts that the staff follow have risers and reminders in there, so that if some staff may forget to ask a certain piece of information from the caller before they can move on to the next step in the script, there'll be a reminder that will pop up in front of them on the screen, and they will basically make sure that they're asking for everything that we need. The measurements around that has been really, really impressive. It's reduced our processing time in the back of house on transactions from an average of 34 days, in council tax particularly, to around about 16 days. So just by something as easy as reviewing what we're asking our customers and making sure that we're meeting the needs of what those questions need to be, it's reducing avoidable contact. Core performance screens. I know that in the past, where I've worked, there's always been visibility of performance across contact centres and customer-facing services. So we've actually acquired some screens that we've now in the process of putting up across the contact centre, so that walking through the contact centre, visibility of our performance is constantly there in front of you. The agents already see this on the screen in front of them, but I just think it's important for visitors to be able to see how well we actually do with the call handling. And I know that is something that will be challenged and is often challenged, but the performance statistics that we produce on average do show, and I've presented this on a number of occasions to members, that we do on average answer most of the calls within 4 minutes. And I do get the horror stories. I do get the emails where, you know, constituents and residents have waited 16 minutes, 18 minutes, and there's real heat that surrounds. And I don't disregard that those occurrences can happen. More so around revenues and benefits services as opposed to street scene, where I do believe that the statistical data doesn't reflect. The performance data doesn't reflect the perception that often goes with what is fed back to our members and through our customer accident, you know, customer contact. So that moves me on to what I think is really key. It's a pledge that I've made in front of members, and I've said that when we start to get things right by implementing all these, we're going to implement customer service surveys as well, so that we've got real measurements around what the customer experience was like. You can't measure customer experience from how long they waited to be answered. The real true customer experience, in my view, is, was the customer satisfied at the end of the call? And that is something that I'm really keen to be able to measure. So what we will do is we will actually engage with our customers and call them back. There's no expectation for them to be hanging on the phone for an additional 2 or 3 minutes to do the survey. We're conscious that that is their call coming through to us. So we've made a pledge to phone back and really measure what the customer experience has been like. And I'm really keen to be able to report that back. And I've actually recently said to Cabinet SLT that I'm really, you know, pleased about the progress that we're making. And I will come back and I will tell you how we've done. Additional staff was a demand, well, demand, it was an ask from the Cabinet SLT, particularly from the leader, and that was around the leaders away weekend, where the high on the agenda was people waiting a long time to get through. I can't disregard that, but I do think that the statistics do challenge that, but nevertheless, what we've done is we've applied to the transformation fund, and we've guaranteed on a fixed term basis through this period of getting it right some staff to support specific areas in need. So for example, maybe pest control in the street scene or around those areas of need, and we're doing some real analysis on where those key areas are. So I think what I'm saying is there's a lot of work underway. It's been a real challenge in 12 months for me. It's been a real journey and experience, but I do believe that we're heading in the right direction. I think the vision for the future, what we need to embrace is there's a need for us to move forward digitally. But what I'm really keen to underline is that doesn't remove the other customer access channels. And I think when my colleagues last presented around